Not only has our forest management and harvesting changed over the last century, but also how we process the wood and engineer improvements into wood products, further expanding the possibilities of wood as a resource. With log yield maximizing strategies came the 2x4, as well as the process of peeling logs for veneer production. Veneer lumber is used in both plywood and engineered beams. Logs can be chipped down and used to create high-strength OSB panels and I-joist web material. Today's processes utilize 100% of the logs, with none of the material going to waste. Improving our processing techniques enable better performance out of lower quality wood and uses less wood fiber. For over a decade, light wood frame mid-rise buildings have been flooding the U.S. residential multifamily market. From high-end downtown locations to the suburbs, these buildings have been providing housing for thousands of families. It is in this market that engineered wood products, and especially SCL or structural composite lumber, is providing cost-effective structural wood solutions, addressing the load transfer and span requirements demanded by today's consumer occupants. However, it wasn't until just recently that after a gap of over 100 years that mid-rise buildings are now allowed back within the province of British Columbia.
We're very excited about mid-rise construction coming to Canada. We think it's long overdue. We've been supplying projects in the U.S. now for many, many years. Through that, we've developed a lot of expertise on how these buildings go together. Now, with that coming to Canada and specifically BC, we're well positioned to provide the technical support and the products that the market needs to construct these types of buildings.
This construction form provides an economical solution to rising land and construction expenses through reduced building time and competitive material costs. Decades of suburban growth has resulted in increasing costs for local governments when faced with providing infrastructure and services such as streets, water, and waste management. Sustainable densification through taller housing projects addresses this very issue, and using wood frame mid-rise construction for infill projects, be they in cities or in suburban town centers, can greatly assist in creating sustainable communities and neighborhoods.
I think for mid-rise construction, builders have realized that it is an affordable way to build, and land is at a premium in this province. We know that. There are other provinces such as Ontario where land is a large premium as well. So it's all about getting the most amount of units you can and within the land size that you have to build within. So we see here builders that are very prevalent in multifamily going to six-story construction, recognizing that that gives them more units and really builds the density that large cities like Vancouver so badly need.
But make no mistake, these structures are designed differently than low-rise buildings, and an integrated design team approach is strongly recommended to address all of the necessary nuances when it comes to these taller buildings. A perfect example of this is found in Library Square, located in Kamloops, British Columbia.
So this is a six-story structure with five levels of wood over one level of concrete. The one level of concrete houses 20,000 square feet of library and about 9,000 square feet of retail space. Those uses wouldn't happen in an all six-story wood frame building without the support of the concrete level that acts as both structural and fire protection to the rest of the units above.
Right. Yeah, we've seen many examples of this just south of us in Washington, Oregon, and even California.
When we designed the building, we designed it as a steel and concrete building. But with the downturn in the economic condition in 2008, we had to look at other means to go ahead and get the building in. We were fortunate that BC Building Code changed and allowed us to go to wood.
So was your change based solely on economics?
I think you're going to find that these type of projects, especially in urban environments where housing is in short supply and there's a demand for densification, that the sustainable and prudent way to design a building of this type is to go to wood.
There must have been some design challenges. How did you deal with them?
The code allowed us to go to six stories in wood, and there clearly were some restrictions that we had to go ahead and look at. The first of them would be that the six-story top floor couldn't be more than 18 meters above grade. There's a building requirement, a building area requirement for not more than 12,000 square feet. And then there are the issues that we technically have to deal with in terms of shrinkage. And some of the ways that we dealt with that were to keep as many of the products of the structure in wood. For instance, our elevator is in wood. The joists are engineered wood joists. The frame system itself, we treated in a controlled environment and brought it on site, so it had very low moisture content.
Were they prefab panels?
They were prefab panels, and they were bought on site. They only had about a 10 to 12% moisture content, and that served us very well. Decks were also important to look at, and because they were loaded on a post and beam system, we had to make sure that they shrunk in accordance with the shrinkage of the building. So they started with a steeper slope, and then as the building shrunk, so too did the decks, to give us a positive slope at the end of the day.
So do the units vertically stack?
We did stack the units vertically, and there's some very good positive effects for that. By doing that, certainly all the building services that are in the building, such as plumbing and piping, sprinkler systems, and even the structural tie rods, for instance, all aligned in a good vertical manner.
Now, you mentioned sprinkler systems. I understand the requirements now for this type of building is NFPA 13.
When we're dealing with a low-rise building, you can go to NFPA 13R. In this case, we have to jump it up a notch and go to 13 NFPA 13. The requirements there, of course, is that the sprinkler system had to cover all of the rooms in the building, not quite the same as in a low-rise building. The piping system had to be increased, and then certainly we're looking at penetrations through the firewalls and through the demising walls that also had to be looked at. We were fortunate to go ahead and have a very good code consultant and fire consultant on board that assisted us in all of those penetrations.
Also, the code change mentioned the exterior cladding and its requirement for it to be non-combustible. How did you tackle that issue?
You're right. The code does require non-combustible cladding on six-story buildings. There are limited choices on that. In this particular building, we went with stucco for a good portion of it, and we accented it with brick.
Lightwood frame construction has historically been the most economical way to construct buildings. The material is in abundant supply and can be sourced locally. It's easy to carry around on a job site, so installation is quick, and you have a large and reliable workforce to draw upon.
There's just way more trades available that work with wood than that work with steel.
The low-mass wood wall and floor assemblies also reduce the substructure's foundation needs, along with its associated impacts on the environment, budget, and schedule. The phasing aspect of wood frame construction, along with the densification attributes of mid-rise construction, allow developers to build housing stock while limiting the longer-term risk commonly found with high-rise buildings, which could take years to build out.
Our project is a mixed-use project with the library on the ground floor. When we looked at going with wood and the code changed, we thought that was excellent because we knew it had been done in the States. Economically, there's an overall cost difference. There's a time margin, and time is money in this business. And the fact that we used wood, we just motored right through. We actually got it that people are moved in and we're finished. The setting is really nice for the people with the shopping center across the way, and the building is economical and the view is superb. One of the benefits is that your higher floors sell better and everybody wants to be on the highest floor. So we're getting, well, extra sales volume because we're selling the higher floors at a premium. So you got a view regardless of which side of the building you're on, and people are buying it for what they see. We've had nothing but positive comments about the project. As to who to get on board, you need everyone on board. First of all, the design team, the city, anyone in the approval industry. You've got a bank to convince. But there's others, like the realtors need to be convinced, the marketing and their marketing, which impacts the financing. I know this for sure, that if we were doing another six-story building, we wouldn't even consider steel. We would be going straight to wood.
We have a pretty good working relation with all of our construction industry in the city of Kamloops, and we all work together because it's a team approach. It's not just them or us, it's us, all of us, working together, building a better city. To the best of my knowledge, we had nothing but success in this project because it worked out the way we planned. Because this is the first project we had where the six-story wood frame construction building was being proposed in the city of Kamloops, so we were looking forward to the final results. Our team worked very hard on this from day one. We wanted to make sure all the I's were dotted and T's were crossed. One of our concerns was the safety on the job site, and we made sure that all the safety aspect is looked after during construction, and we brought that to the attention of the developer and the general contractor. Our fire department was also providing them enough information so they don't run into any roadblocks. The biggest help we received at that time, because it was a new, unique, and the help and assistance we received from the Canadian Wood Council representative, that was great, because they kept working with us and assisting us if there was any questions. When you start a project, have everybody sitting on the same table so they all can hear what's happening, and making sure that they are ready to work on the project, and if there's any concern or questions, then they have first-hand information instead of getting from third party.
So some of the precautions before a project gets going, for me, was to involve the building department, involve your fire department, go over the building, the site, the plan, involve everybody on the step of the way, so that if something is, catch something or we see something coming up that may be a problem, that we can address it before they get to it. So it's just good communication amongst all those departments, and I think that'll probably alleviate a lot of concern or problems before they actually get there. No, I just want to add that during this project, we really did have a really good relationship with Tri-City Contracting, Tom McNeil, the project manager there, and our ability to phone him at any time, or our ability to have our crews access the site to see how the project is coming along. That went really well, and in working with the building department here in the city of Kamloops, we have a really good relationship, so if we had any questions code-wise, we were able to confer with them and just make sure everything was good and actually meet on site with our building department. So that's overall, it gave us a good comforting feeling that when you work together with the companies, the fire department, the building department, you can look at the issues and come to solutions.
All I can say that it was a great pleasure to work with the general contractor and CWC, also with all the other teams, players, our fire department, engineering team, code consultant. They all pitched in, and you can see the end result that we have a good project. It's very hard for me to say what will happen in other provinces, but if they have any question or concern, we'll be happy to share our experience with them.
I'm here with Tom McNeil, the project manager for Tri-City Contracting, the owner and developer of this project. Tom, being that this was the first mid-rise building, I'm sure most of the challenges or tasks were part of your responsibility in ensuring that this building went up correctly.
Well, it was quite a challenge, actually. Probably the schedule, it was a very tight schedule at that point. I spent a lot of time at the beginning of the project, like getting involved with the fire department and the city of Kamloops, and you yourself even, and a lot of good suggestions came from you as far as fire safety and how we were going to do things, and we did incorporate a lot of everybody's suggestions into the design. We're quite comfortable building them now and definitely had a good experience here. Whether you're dealing with steel, wood, or concrete, I think the principles of success are all the same. So somebody doing it for their first time, I would definitely say do the research if you can and take it very seriously. I can't see anybody building a four-story anymore if a six-story is permitted, just from your an economic point of view when you're marketing these housing. Like it just, if you're going to put in a foundation, you might as well go up as high as you're permitted from the law of economics anyway. So I would definitely say they're here to stay. At the end of the day, if the six-story wood was a success, it was a success for us, because we're an up-and-coming company growing all the time, and we'll definitely be doing more wood building, so it's good for everybody in the BC economy.
Engineers that are comfortable in wood had no problem going to five and six stories. We've broken ground now with five and six-story construction, It is no longer new, and therefore engineers and architects that are concerned about it should really look at these projects and see that, that they actually went up very well. We've seen and had good feedback from builders and engineers that have done these jobs already, and they've gone off very smoothly.
Wood makes sense in this type of construction, it really does, in many aspects. One of them is the lateral performance of the building. Because of the redundancy of multiple members in this type of construction, there's great ductility and excellent energy absorption in the frame when it's experienced either wind or a seismic event. We can cover a couple of examples in this situation right now. Just directly above us, the builder elected to use engineered wood I-joists as the roof framing material. They've taken advantage of that for a number of reasons. Oftentimes you need that longer span to achieve the results that the architect has laid before the structural engineer. So another example of use of engineered wood product is right in front of us here above this window. They've used engineered wood as the headers or the beams over the windows. That results in a much more stable frame. Just above that, there are a number of blocking panels that are also an important part of the structural system here. When we're up at this level on the sixth floor, there's a lot of wind exposure. And what's happening is this wall is going to experience some wind forces. It's important that the top of that wall be braced back to something stable, and that's what we're seeing in this case. Once those loads reach that window header, then the next thing they must do is transfer down and around the window. Clearly the glass itself can't take the load, and so primarily that header is working to transfer gravity loads from above, down, and through the framing system below. So here we are at the third floor, and what we're starting to see is the effect of loads being built up through the structure. If you recall, up at this level, there was no framing like this before, but now they have to insert framing. There are three members here to transfer loads from upper levels down into this structure. If you notice, there are three studs here to pick up that load. So typically what we'll see in this joist cavity is a matching number of studs to the amount of studs that are below here. Similarly, when we're looking over on the joists, because the loads are starting to build up, engineers may occasionally specify extra framing on the side of the joist to bring loads down and through to the structure below. By the time we reach the lowest level of this framing, the amount of cripples that we need to transfer the load has grown to four. There are four of them here, matching the four studs that are used to transfer the loads through the entire wall system. At this level, to deal with the vertical load transfer, we now move from having one squash block on one side of the joist to having a squash block on both sides of the joist, and that's just purely to deal with the enhanced vertical loads that are coming through the building. By this point, the vertical loads are substantial, so what we're seeing here is the party wall between these two units has studs that are on a very tight on-center spacing to deal with the vertical load. Just as importantly, in order to manage that vertical load during the construction phase, there's blocking in between the studs to prevent buckling, which is a critical safety measure when you're talking about loads like this.
Structural wood products are used to transfer loads and hold these buildings up. But to address another nuance of mid-rise construction, we need to look at what holds these buildings down.